teachers. Now let's welcome Professor Pau-Choo from National Cheng University. The speech is entitled Inertial Sensor-Based Wearable Device on Healthcare. Let's welcome.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Today is my great pleasure to share with you some of our experience. And I also hope that with this topic, we can have some of the extension collaboration. Who would like to use the same technique to extend to healthcare analysis? So today my title is set on the Inertial Sensor-Based Wearable Devices on Healthcare. As mentioned, I was from National Cheng University from in Thailand, Taiwan. As we know, the recent years, the IoT has been a hot topic. It's been used not only in smart living or smart home, smart environment. It was also highly emphasized on healthcare, particularly recently because of the AI, who suggests to become one of the technique, so that some of the signals collected from the IoT can have more of intelligent or algorithm embedded with it. And so we will be able to use it for our healthcare. As everyone might have known, that many of the company like Google, Microsoft, they all set up their so-called healthcare platform. Like Google has the Apple Watch, and this is the device, somehow they combine various kind of sensors, like in the blood pressure, or even the activity for sleeping, understanding, or even heartbeat. And this kind of device can prevent us from restricted in the hospital, so that our patients or our elderly can be stay in home and have a continuous understanding of their health situation. Normally in this kind of situation, it is important that this kind of collected this device are able to connect it with outside world. That means the cloud platform or system. So iPhone is one of the possibility. Or otherwise, this device has to be have ad hoc network or special sensor, so it can connect with internet device in our home. Then it can be sent into the cloud device for analysis. And you might think, how come there are so many of the companies who put so much effort on this area? This is one of the estimation from the, we call business side. He indicated that the digital healthcare application is one of the approach who can prevent our patients being restricted. So now, especially now we are in pandemic seasons, if we can stay home and being connected with the doctor or our physicians, it is a better way, so it can prevent us from the disease spreading. And secondly, it can also give us a more continuous understanding of healthcare. So you know that if we go to the hospital to see the doctor, that is only one time of instant data evaluation. That is only when you go to the hospital, your blood pressure or your ECG will be measured or your temperature will be measured. But when you go home, it might have your temperature might go out again, or your heart might have your heartbeat might be normal again, but you're already not in the hospital. So the doctor will not know what is happening to you. So but with the wearable device, with our sensor advance in on healthcare, combined with this to be made into the wearable device, then it can prevent us. That means it set us free from restricted hospital. We can be at home and have the continuous data monitored and sent to the cloud and to the doctor. And because of that reason, everyone is looking for this direction. And another, because of that, now the Internet of Things, there's one term called Internet of Medical Things. That means we extend the Internet of Things into the medical device. So this is so-called Internet of Medical Things, and is expected to go up to 158 billion in 2022, compared to in 2017 is only 41 billion. So that means there's a lot of the opportunity that there is a good market in this area. And so because of that, I would like to share with you some of the possibility which has been used. We know that for the blood pressure continuous monitoring, or ECG monitoring, or your temperature monitoring, glucose monitoring, that is important. And that is usually the analysis for this kind of data is to associate your event with this data and to see whether you have your personal have special special setting. For example, someone thinks that this is a heartbeat is probably not normal, but for you, you might have a special characteristic in your body. So the threshold setting will be different. And we also, I'm trying to report is we try to the inertial sensor in the wearable device for Alzheimer's patients understanding. Because you know, the Alzheimer's patients is one kind of disease that the patient will gradually lose their memory and their cognitive, their cognition. That means once the Alzheimer's disease is happened, it will go through mild and then serious. Once it's serious, it may completely have dementia. It will have dementia. That means it would lose the recognition or memory, and the cognition will be impaired. And because of that, because of this cognition impairment, it will cause a working balance disorder. Because of that, so if we can have used this inertial sensor to measure their balance, then we can have some of the understanding for this person before it has a quite a good balance. How come gradually in this period the balance has been significantly reduced? So in that case, we will be able to see the indication. And another thing that it can be used is for the walking pattern. Because of your cognitive impairment, sometimes because for our normal people, our walking seems a very natural way. But once it is you have the cognitive impairment, actually when I'm walking, we are looking around. So we understand, and at the same time, because this understand doesn't cause us too much load, so we can walk very nicely. But if you have the kind of cognitive degradation seriously, it will take some of your mental load. So it will distract your walking pattern. So in the literature record, it has reported that for the Alzheimer's patient, some of them shows slow of walking pattern compared to the normal people. So in that case, we can go through the inertial sensor device collective and see their signal and do the analysis and to see whether how is this walking pattern compared to the normal people. And you can, so that we can show that as one of the diagnoses. And another is, for people, if you try to see their sleeping and daily activity, sometimes they will be, because of their cognitive change or because of they have the healthcare problems. So their sleeping and the daily activity could be changed due to this disease. But this disease could be the health or the, from the mental. So some of the people, if they are very anxiety, they will keep get up during the night or during the daytime. And if they have a very distraction, then they might sit there very quiet for a very long time. So from the daily activity behavior, it can be have so of the indicator for a person's health or mental disorder. Because of that, I would like to share with you some of our example and our experiment. We have working with National Cheng Kung University Hospital physicians to analyze the Alzheimer's patients. We try to ask the patient to do the dual task working. You might wonder what is dual task working. Normally we walk, we can ask the patient to walk and to see the walking pattern. For that situation, we call it single task walking, because all the patient has to do, all the elderly has to do, is just to walk. However, for the dual task walking, we try to use some of the function. For example, we ask them to do other tasks. For example, ask them to count down from 100 to 1 instead of count up. Count down takes much more loading in our mental. So if they have to count and at the same time to walk, then because of this big word counting takes their mental loading. So in that case, if you are a normal elderly, because you have a significant, you have enough your cognitive capability, your mental is health, so you can afford this. But if you are an Alzheimer's patient, then you, because your capability is not so good enough already, so it will give you lots of distraction. Because of this counting give you the distraction, so you, that will disturb your walking. You will suddenly stop, or during your walk, or walk much more slower during your walk. So we compare to this and to do the statistical analysis, then we will be able to know, or at least shows us as one of the indicator for this elderly, whether they have a cognitive disparity. And in order for the sensor to do the balance analysis, our approach is to ask the patient to wear the sensor in the waist like this. And then this is projected to the ground. And then we try to analyze the projection of this ground, this signal on the ground, and see how the signal on the ground has been changed or swayed. And then you will know, based on that, we will know the whether its balance is good enough. And this slide shows the step how we do the to do the projection from our signal collected from the inertial sensor to the plane, XY plane, and to compute the distance of the swaying. I don't want to go through all this. This is just a very basic projection theory. Because this sensor collected XYZ direction signal, so basic signal you can compute the direction in this magnitude and project to the XY plane. And based on this XY plane, you will be able to compute the swaying in these four words, we call it AP direction sway and ML direction sway. normal AP situation sway means that your body has like the tail to the front or the back. And unmetal sway means your body has a sway from the left and the right. And normal people, they will be able to stand well with a good balance with your COM, center of mass, in the whole body of the center. But if you have the cognitive impairment, then it might cause you to sway slightly. So based on we analyze this swaying degree, then we will be able to know whether the patient has a good balance or not. This is some of the signal we collected for them. This is PowerPoint, and the patient will, in the AP displacement or ML displacement. So, and based on that, then you can compute how serious it has been swayed away from the center of the mass, from center. And then you can see, compute the degree in the different pyramid, different area, and to see the difference between the normal and subject. This is a figure we have collected from our patient. And based on this, we can try to analyze whether the normal patient or how much it is can be swayed. All right. You might think that when we collected the signal, okay? So from our, in order to do the signal collection, as I have mentioned before, we usually at least in the hospital, we usually do some of the tests like this I have mentioned. One is you just stand still. It's easy, it's much more easier. Whether you can stand just still for a certain of time, for a few minutes, and or you can stand for how long. And we would also test them to see if they can stand sideways with eyes closed. This is with eyes open, and this is with eyes closed. You know that once we have closed our eyes, we have less balance capability. You should try. Because once you close your eyes, because you don't have the eyes to look around your environment, so it will become harder for you to maintain your balance. So it's open your eyes and close your eyes. And then the next one is try to stand one foot in the front and the other foot on the back. We call tandem stand, okay? Tandem stand. And it's still with your open eyes or with your closed eyes, or with your eyes closed. Again, closed eyes and open eyes will give you different, your capability for balancing, imbalancing, all right? And you would, for this tandem stand, you can have one, for example, left foot in the front or right foot in the front. So you have different tandem. You have this tandem and then you have this tandem. One is in the right foot in the front, the other is on left foot in the front. And then again, with open eyes or closed eyes. And then this one is even harder. That means you use one foot to stand, okay? Supposedly you would say that we ask them to stand on left foot, open eyes and close eyes. Supposedly we should do that. But after we discuss with the physician, we remove the experiment for the one foot stand with close eyes. The reason is, with one foot to stand, you already need very significant to do the balancing. And these elderly, they already do not have enough capability of the balancing. And so if we ask them to close their eyes, it's relatively dangerous. So we don't do that experiment. Of course, if you think your elderly has enough can tolerate this kind of the loading, they can you can of course you can ask them to with left foot stand and open eyes and then close eyes. But we don't do that because our elderly are from the potentially Alzheimer's disease patients, so their loading are already low. So that kind of activity will give them the dangerous behavior. So after that, so we have 8 static balance tests. And based on this, we can try to use, as I mentioned to you, this kind of the algorithm or the way of to measure how the patient has been swayed from the ML, that means from left to right, or AP from front to the back, and to see how sway this in the different region. Okay, so you can do the analysis and to compare your AD and the Alzheimer's patient and the health control. That means a healthy elderly. Of course, in our test, it is also important. If it is related to healthcare, it is important that this comparison has to be in the same base. What does it mean? You cannot ask the health control from the young, for example, 20 years or 30 years young generation, and ask the AD from the 60 years or 70 years. It is not in a fairly or in a high quality of the control. So normally we collect the healthy control or the elderly also those without Alzheimer's disease elderly, but they are also about 60 or 70 years old. So they are all the same age and the same standard background. And then we can compare this healthy and elderly and see what are the different significant difference. Normally the elderly will shows rule worse than the health person. Okay, this is one of kind of test. Of course, you can use this to do. The reason I post this is you can use it to do large of the data collection, and then to do analyze, and also for the same individual, you can do this gradually for a long time, and then you can see how is the trend changing. For example, they can do, for example, for month. Once every week or once every month, and then you can see how the data has been changing. And another test we've been used is we call TUGT test, which is also being used in the hospital for test the patient's capability. The TUGT test is ask the patient to sit on the chair and stand up, and then walk for a few distance, for example, 3 meters, and then they turn back and then sit down. And we try to measure first how long it takes for them to do this activity. Okay. And before the physician or the nurse has to use the stopwatch and to measure how long the elderly has can stand up and sit down, stand up and sit down for 5 times, and to walk for 3 meters and come back, sit down, takes how long? How long would it take? How long would it take? So usually would use someone in the beside and use the stopwatch and watch it. So you know that it's not detailed. First, you cannot know it's turning a wrong time. And you also need someone to do that. So we are trying to develop and to do the analysis and to analyze this working in this in these shoes and also the balance in here and see how time and how it turn, how long it turn from here to there and how long it take really work. And because their sensor are also wear on the foot, so on both feet, so they can also collect their gait or the pattern, whether the both feet, the pattern are balanced or not. So these are we have been doing. So we try to analyze the signal from the sensor wear on the foot, And we try to decompose the signal to different stage. This is a figure shows how we people work. We usually, this is called push off, that is, we kind of raise up our leg, and then we swim forward, and then we touch down. Normally we touch down from our heel, and then we put our front side, then we put the, finally become this, and become the stand face. So our walking cycle is start like this, and circular step one after step. So we would like try to see, this we call it swing state. That means is the people's foot is on the air, and these are the time they have touched on the ground, okay? So in order to do that, we have process we need. Actually, this one, I should put it in the front. Actually, for this inertial sensor, no matter is for balancing or in the walking pattern, for this, we usually do device calibration, and for the correct signal, we do some of the pre-processing, for example, to remove the noise, and then really decompose the data into the stand phase and dynamic phase, or swing phase. That is when the foot has touched on the ground, and so we can decompose the signal into one step after one step. So we know this signal composed is one step of the walking, and this is another step. So based on that, then you can do the further analysis. And after you have the decomposed the data into segment, each segment is one step, then you can do extract some of the feature and analyze it, do classification, or even you can to build a model and to see whether the patient's working model is like that, or if you can, whether the model has been changed. So this is, so for that, this is shows the one of the signal, working phase. This is what we call dynamic area, this is stem phase. So one of that is try to decompose, try to segment this out, try to do that. Based on this signal, we know that it's easier. Some of you may say, whether I need to deep learning for that, of course not. For this signal, it's easier. It's easy, you can do very precise decomposition from this dynamic. And this is some of the algorithm you can use, just use easy threshold for that, okay? So if you can decompose it into, include, this is dynamic, we call it dynamic interval, and the stand, this is the foot that is touching on the ground and not moving, okay? So based on this first, we will suggest for you to do the signal filtering that is smooth the signal. If you are on the signal processing area, you know that easily is just an average moving, smoothing. That means within a window, you do the average. Then your signal will look much smoother, not as spiky as in previous figure. And then so that you can decompose it, it will become light, and you can decompose one after the other. And then you can compute the signal, you can calculate the signal. This shows x, y, z. The inertial sensor has a y, z direction, so you can do the signal magnitude. And based on the signal magnitude, you can use as window size to see whether during the window size how variance it is. If it is a large variance, that means it will be in this area. So if you use from a large variance, starting from large variance, then that means this is the starting point of one of the dynamic area. And if the signal goes to low variance like this, then you means this is another area for this low area. So it's easy for you to decompose this signal. And once that you know this is one of step and stand, one of step and stand, so you can do all the kind of analysis here. And it is fast, so you can cut, you can use the step by step. You can cut down step by step, step by step. And once you got this cut down by step, it's easier for you to compare the different step, one step after another step. It's easier for you. Okay, so then you can you can decide, you can decompose this gas cycle and the into diameter area and also toe to find where is the heel strike, where is toe of, here is the, okay. Okay, and this is some of our analyze. I didn't clearly show that what parameter we have do. We have do several. One is we try to count how fast the people walk, as I mentioned, because the speed, the walking pattern, the speed is one of the indicator for Alzheimer's patient. Indication that he might have cognitive degradation. So this is one of the speed, and we also try to show the cadence, the time that is in the air and also in the on the ground, on the air, and also we try to see the regularity. That means one step after the other, whether the each step is very regularly. Okay, based on our experiment, it was very interesting. I didn't show in here. It was very interesting that during the countdown, when you count from, for example, you change the decimal, That means you count from 30, and then to 29. In that instant, some of the elderly, their step will be, much slower. That means that step will stay longer. That shows some of the indication that when our countdown from 30 to 29, or from 40 to 39, that is, that is much harder than the normal counting. So we show that there are some of the indicator, and also we see whether the right foot and the left foot have the similar, and so that is some of the, and the we try to see whether the AD and the health control have some of the difference. Okay, and this we show some of the comparison. We try to see AD and the health control. Normally, health control has much better. It takes less time to walk. It takes less time to count the hand step. But for the lens, the step lens, it doesn't show much. It has, but for the single task and dual task, it doesn't show much difference. But for the time it takes, for the single task and the dual task, it shows the difference. Okay, so you can see that you can, based on that, you can see whether a health subject, health control, and the Alzheimer's patient, whether they have a significant difference. And of course, once you know how to analyze this signal, you can generate all kind of idea and to do the statistics for these patients. Okay, so there are many kinds of, once you can do that, you can try to figure out what kind of parameter you would like to do, and you can do on either in a cohort group of the patients, or you want to do on each individual and see their long-time history change. Okay. And this is some of the reference related to that. Of course, these are healthcare. And so in the front part are some related sensor. We also do some of the understanding using the wireless camera in the nursing center. So some of them are the nursing center, which related the video understanding. Okay. So if you are interested on using the IoT or sensor, we use the RGB sensor, website camera. We also use the thermal sensor because in order to reduce the privacy issue, thermal sensor is one of the ideas someone has been tried to be actually in the nursing center. So we can identify, we can actually, based on that, to know the patient's or the elderly daily behavior, okay? And during now, I would like to stop for use a few minutes as an advertisement. After that, then I will talk about another short break, short topic on sleeping pattern, okay? We organize one of international conference called International Computer Symposium. It's ICS 2020. If you look for ICS 2020, please put Taiwan. Otherwise, there will be another ICS 2020 on the internet, okay? International Computer Symposium. Now, our paper submission deadline is September 8th. So we would like to invite you, you'll submit the paper. And the main theme on this symposium is AI drives our future life. It includes, the topic includes 5G, advanced network, intelligent network, current artificial intelligence in our healthcare, in smart manufacture or smart environment, or even on education. And it also includes some of the, even your algorithm or your multimedia analysis. So, and the paper will be published on IEEE Explore, collected in IEEE Explore. And for the regular paper, which requires we suggest 4 to 6 pages to be included in IEEE Explore. We also offer the best paper award. We will select a few of best paper from the area. And the place this conference has both online and also physical, because in Taiwan, the COVID-19 is relatively controlled. I should say it's controlled. Okay, so we have the event will be in Shangri-La Far Eastern Hotel in Tainan City, which is just near the train station. So you take high speed rail there, take the train to Tainan train station. Once you exit from the rail exit, you will see this hotel. And during this event, the banquet and the lunch will be provided for your registration. The registration is only 9,000, which is less than 300 US dollars, about 300 US. We provide you a banquet and also the lunch in Sangria Hotel. For our friends from abroad or from other country, if you like to travel to Taiwan, we will welcome you, but you need for probably a few days of quarantine. But we also offer the online presentation, and then your paper will be also included in IEEE. So we also offer the online presentation. So both physical and online presentation are used. So if you are here, you can have the social, but you can also attend online. So, okay? And sorry, I use a few words in Chinese because this is only for the for local people, which means that we also invite quite a lot of the industrial to be on exhibition. And we also organize so-called talent match. That means we use the recruiting. We offer the opportunity for the industrial to recruit their faculty on the event. And then we have a section for the industrial to present or to show what kind of people they want and what kind of opportunity they offer for these possible candidates. So for the students, especially if you are graduating in next year, it's a good opportunity for you to find the job there. So it kind of job match, okay? And in Ministry of Education Taiwan, we has AI talent cultivation program. The AI cultivation, talent cultivation program result will be also co-organized co-held in the same event, the same place. So you will see the even also some of the how the people how the university or high school they are promoting this AI education. Okay, so that's it. Okay. And finally, I would like to also include a few slides about extend our inertial sensor to sleeping pattern analysis. This is one of the examples our students to extend our data, our sensor. Okay, so we, because we already developed this sensor, this sensor ball, so our students also try to extend the use of this sensor into sleeping pattern behavior analysis. Instead of have this sensor well on hand, because your hand can, you can swing all around, but your body might not actually moving. Okay, so we try to see if we try to embed this sensor on our clothes, where should be the best place to put? And simultaneously, we developed some of the algorithm to do the analysis of the people's sleeping behavior. Okay. The sensor we have tested is here. One is in the abdomen, and one is on the chest, and the two are on the shoulder, on left shoulder and right shoulder, left shoulder and the right shoulder. So we try to test these four sensors to see this, if I embed the sensor in different position, where would be the best place for us to embed this sensor? And for our analysis, we try to analyze this patient, the sleeping posture, whether it's supine or right lateral, left lateral, or prone position. Okay, and in order to do that, we proposed, we would like to also know whether this elderly, these people or this elderly has actually not only in the sleeping different pose position, whether they turn around very often, we would also see whether they actually get out of the bed. Because for the elderly, sometimes they wake up during the night, and go to the restroom quite often. So we think if we can use this kind of wearable device, and at the same time, if they get out of the bed, and I know they actually get out of the bed and walk to the restroom, so I know that it's different from the. So we try to analyze the sleeping quality not only in different sleeping posture, but also whether they stand up and walking. Okay. Supposedly you have, for example, like this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Supposedly you have seven situation or seven events activity to analyze. But you know that during the our sleeping, if you are in supine position, you want to turn to the right lateral. You need to turn to the right. You cannot jump and suddenly to the right, right? It's impossible. So during our experiment, we found out that if we also impose some of the stay here to analysis, I kind of quickly jump to the result. So we found out that if we pose some of the states in between, and we try to detect, it helps you to get much accurate detection from this supine to this position to another position. So you will not because of that sort of the miss. So in the long run, in finally, we try to use that as this. And we try to use the state transition as an assistant for our analysis. And in order to do that, this is some of roughly algorithm. First of course, signal calibration, signal analysis, right? So I don't want to repeat. And then we have the event detection. What is event detection? Because during you are sleeping, you might have a very long time of the period, long time of period, stay still. So we try to see, anyway, we try to similar like the walking pattern, we try to find the dynamic area, dynamic range. So we try to detect the motionless and the moving pattern area, and try to detect the starting and ending point of each moving and the motionless action. We try to do that. Okay. Okay. And so we can change segment E2 into segment 2, the signal into a segmentation. For example, like this. Because we as YZ, and this is the chest the signal. This is signal on the chest. This is signal on the left shoulder. And so this means that people are sleeping quite a long time. And so we would like to segment out this dynamic area, segment this area. So it's easily we do some of derivative and use one of the threshold to do that, okay, to do the absolute value and accumulate three axis value, we have mentioned SVG, anyway, you just try to compute the magnitude of this signal, as we have mentioned the XYZ signal, okay? So you can try to analyze, and so you can easily to detect it. And we also found out that because you are moving, sometimes you will have slightly moving. Even you are sleeping, you don't actually change your posture. You don't actually change. But your hand, your body, your breathing actually will have smooth moving, okay? And secondly, during you are turning your body, if you see the child sleeping, they can even turning around, not just flip their body. They can turning around. It could be the morning, their head is in this side, and I wake up, the head on the other side. So you know that they can turning around. So it's very interesting that if I try to analyze this signal, as I mentioned, if you try to analyze the signal in this dynamic area, it's much challenging for you to set up the threshold. You see, some are so low and some are so high. Some are so low, some are so high. So in this situation, for you to better use it, is on the other side, you try to detect this, we call it motionless period. Because motionless period is much more stable. It's much more stable. But for your dynamic area, the signal has been, very, spiky, and some of the spiky, if you look at it, some of the signal might be down to like very low, some are very high. So it would be very hard. It would be, we tried, it's much harder for you to set up a criteria for you to segment this out, and if you do on this. But if you do on this, and to count that this signal has to be that value in a certain period of time, okay, then it's much easier for you to identify that this is the motionless area, motionless period. Once you get out the motionless period, the remaining are the motion period, all right? So you don't have to worry about the motion period. This is the same experience as we have to on medical image analysis. If you look at the medical image analysis, like a breast mammogram, the breast region has the dark region, white region, so variation is very large. So if you like to set up a threshold for you to segment out the breast region compared to the background, it's better way is you try to detect the background. Because the background is stable and smooth, so the threshold is easy to get today. But you move the, and once you get out the threshold, and this threshold has to be connected to the region. Like this, it has to be a continuous region. So you would not, you say that if there's a small signal here, but it's not in continuous in this here, so it would not be included You can easy. So it will be easier. You get out this, then you can make a this. And then once you have the signal, all the idea you use that you can do to analyze this signal for sleeping pattern, the same. Okay, you can use it for analyze your sleeping. You can do the signal extraction or do the classification for us. We try to support, we use build it into a support vector machine and then to identify, to do the classification, which position the elderly is on, the person is on for the sleeping posture detection. So once you do that, it will be easier. And then, simple classification. Except when you're doing the classification, as I mentioned, the state transition, you can include it in. It would help a lot. Okay, this state transition, you should include. Make it as a criteria in recognition. Then you will improve. We found out you can improve at least about 10% of accuracy. Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you for attending my talk.
Let's thank Professor Zhang once again for her inspiring speech. Just a gentle reminder, due to the tight schedule, if the speaker does not have time to answer your question, please feel free to send your question by email. Thank you for attending. The next session will begin at 11 right here in this room.